I'd like to welcome all of you. My name is Kornél Németh, and as Mr. Mislivet introduced me, I am a qualified engineer, and at the moment I also work for a large multinational company as an engineering director or technical director. But what is my background? How did I end up in this cooperation project? Basically, pain that motivated me. The pain that probably is not just me, but that's how I feel that we're facing these industrial multinationals. So in this productive system, the pain is apparent, not just where. So basically, we are witnessing technological growth, which is a near exponential growth of the in the number of network devices, which actually works as a catalyst within economy, because it provides opportunities. The challenge, however, is that every productive organization or producer must also have a profits, which are linked to conditions. The conditions are that the technologies must be used, must be understood and implemented. And at this stage, we have to start talking about actually another side to it, which is a sociological side, because it's not just from the production, but from the user side. These discrepancies must be harmonized and eased. The more profit you can generate as a production unit, if you can actually keep this and reduce the gaps. There's an umbrella term that you probably heard, which is Industry 4.0, which we keep seeing and we hear a lot about it. Industry 4.0, when you hear this, we basically production systems now shift towards a decentralized management due to the growth in the number of network devices, which means not only in the production but also in the usings. For example, if you have a light bulb, for example, we had before, but now we have light bulbs that communicate, for example, IoT, which is Internet of Things. How do they relate to production, to users, and what are the interactions that actually take us to the social economic influences and effects? There are relations, obviously, which then reinforce each other and support each other with new demand and hopefully lead to growth. But the situation is more complex than that, because when we talk about change management, this is a good analogue. So if you have a technology mega trend that we see, that's an opportunity for growth, under the surface is what the essence of the whole thing is. So what do industrial units and organizations want? What actually characterizes the state strategies? I just listed a few very important pitfalls that pretty much influence the management of these changes. And if I can just use basically a well-known phrase, we have seen situations like this before. This is the quote from Henry Ford at the time when actually he had technology at hand and there was a change of paradigm at the time. But at the time when people were asked about this question, what they wanted faster horses. But although with horses they reached the end of the potentials, they were the fastest, as fast as they can possibly be. Right now it's the same with industry. people not always able to understand the paradigm shifts, and the most when they ask this question, they want more people, they want better people to work for them, but we have to face up to reality that we don't have them, and this is where this is linked to our models. Most of the education systems and models don't follow or don't provide answers to these change demands. You might be familiar with this picture. This is basically the Industry 4.0. They actually come up with this based on the descriptive analysis. They basically currently, this is, we are at the fourth industrial revolution. Linked to the appearance of network devices. This is what we're witnessing right now, but we know the previous one. So we had the first in the 1730s, 40s, that was the first industrial revolution. Then in the 19th century or early 20th century, the vehicles and then the strong industrial robotics. When we talk about fourth industrial revolution as an umbrella term, we've only seen it just for a few years, but what's behind it, I think we knew for a long time, and this is actually the point when we can discuss Hankish's heritage. These are topics that are very clearly linked to Hankish's heritage, and here I position the Kondratyev waves and the explanations which show that for about the last 100 years the waves of growth and development already been analyzed and described and also characterized. Let me also add that Kondratyev and Schumpeter analysis, actually, they were not motivated by technology, but by economy. So these were actually first economic analysis, and then later they were used for also society to explain the impact on society, improving providing a second angle. But now we can see that the both go to the same direction, because both waves, rows of waves, actually have the same direction. Another thing I just want to continue with is on the left what you see, that a previous production system, the classic production system, had the classic structure because they had enough capacity and the right competences, and this actually gave way to organizations that based on this they were viable. And now we saw the changes. So now we seem to be running out of competencies and capacities. That is why, in order to have an equilibrium, in order not to shift towards a negative, we have to touch organization with the help of technological help, because we have to provide the competency with the bottleneck in capacity to still be viable and profitable. And Professor Mislevet already mentioned a few of these, but this, I think, is the chart that characterizes how these various approaches unify. So just to see the technology, that's the Industry 4.0 and the trends, also then the economy and society or social sciences. So here, at the latter, we have to also look at the individuals and the organizations as well. So basically, the individuals have to accept that the models that were viable and working in the past are not working anymore. This is one of my favorites, just to go on with the previous example. So basically, individual details have a life of their own, so all these elements and how to interpret these elements provide completely a new picture of the same situation. This is what we're at now. This is the situation that we are facing, and I think this is what the hunkish model about the future, the university of the future, is. Interdisciplinary knowledge, that's what we have to provide in order to achieve our goals, both in the terms or all in the terms of society, economy and technology in a combined and aggregated way. I'm talking about aggregated knowledge. And for this University of Future, this new organization, it has a dual function. I'm sure you've seen these questions before. The one in the red bracket, for example, they regularly features in the media. They actually reinforce our worries and fears, but I don't think they are the right questions, because this new type of university also must be able to prepare next generations and society to have a new soft skill, which is to ask the right questions, which requires a change of attitude. Because if they're able to ask the right questions, then on that we can have the right teaching programs can also based on that. So the approach for the future university, there are three phases that we want to implement. First, you just have to open the eyes. They must be aware of the changes and the correlations. The second, which is a step forward, basically in single modules, trainings and conferences, we have to start actually achieving the change in mind. And when we've achieved that, then the audience is ready for competence development for these new modules. And just to elaborate on that, so this is the classical Industry 4.0 model, and these are our visions for the modules that fit. As you can see in the bold letters, that's what we want to highlight, that these are aggregated education modules, including sociology, economy and technological competence that expanded.